more of an exhortation talking to you. And something's ticking at us. Amen. Something. There we go. I think he's got it. Amen. Amen. If you couldn't hear it out there, it was something ticking. Amen. So I didn't know if y'all put a clock on me to make sure I don't preach too long. Book of Luke tonight, chapter 11. And let me see what this. Amen. Let me see something. Hold on 1 second. There we go. Praise the Lord. All right. Luke 11, verse 1 tonight. And PA systems, I love them, but you know, sometimes they attack you too. Yes, amen. So everything's good. Luke 11 and verse 1. And just one verse of Scripture, and I've read this many times, and I'm sure you have as well. But tonight, I just feel to go this direction. And Luke 11 and verse 1 says this, "And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples." Amen. Tonight, this is going to probably be so elementary. Amen. Have you ever heard of prayer? Do you pray? You ain't going to tell me. God knows. Amen. But tonight I want to teach, or not teach, but preach on the idea of learning to pray. And this sounds so simple. And tonight, like I said, I don't know if you can call this preaching or exhorting, but I felt to just exhort the church tonight on the importance of prayer and praying. And we know that it's something that all of us are supposed to do. We all know that. That as Christians, prayer is essential to your walk with the Lord. If you don't pray, I heard one writer said this one time. He said, you'll never find a more prideful man or woman than a man or a woman that will not pray. He said, because if they do not pray, they insinuate and believe that they really don't need God's help. He said, so undermining that prayerless life is really pride. And self is kind of self-exaltation to the place that you don't feel that you have to pray because you feel you have it all figured out. But I don't know about you, church. I ain't got it all figured out yet. I still have to pray. Amen. And tonight, talking about this and just exhorting you, and I don't know how long it'll be or how long God will allow us. I've got so many different verses of Scripture, not really the best outline, but we would understand tonight when it comes to this idea of prayer, how often have you heard somebody say these words, "I will pray for you"? Or how many times have you ever said these words, "I will pray for you"? And have you ever heard somebody came up to you and said, "Will you pray for me?" You would understand that the language throughout Christianity, you'll find that prayer requests and prayer are on the lips of thousands of different people. And we would understand tonight that prayer is needed in every single aspect of your life. Tonight, most likely we could say, we would say when we put in our prayer request, we often say things like this: pray for our families, pray for our children, pray for our daily needs, ministry, relatives, friends, and many other things that we talk about in life that we need prayer for. But I'm going to mention this tonight, and I've preached on it before. Why is it that so few people really pray? Now think about it. I want you to analyze your own life, and I'm not asking you to tell me, because I'll be honest with you. When the other day when I was studying and praying for tonight's service, I said, "Lord, I need to pray more." That's what I said. Amen. "Lord, I need to pray more. There's more I need to do. I need to labor more in the closet of prayer." But my friend, this question that we often ask is this: how much do we really pray? And I did that. It was a survey that was done years ago. I believe it was in the Assemblies of God, that the average Christian prays about 7 minutes a week. Or 7 minutes throughout a span of time. And I thought to myself when I read those statistics before, how much of a shame it is that we do not pray more, because we do understand without prayer, nothing is going to get done. If you do not pray, do not expect your prayers to be answered. Now, I know sometimes God's grace still meets us, and there's times in our life where I've seen God move on things that I haven't even ushered out of my mouth. And I thought to myself, "God, your grace and mercy honestly has moved in this, because I don't really remember praying that, but you knew the need, and I never prayed it." But there's been other times in my life that I found myself on my knees in prayer, crying out to God about certain things, and didn't see my prayers answered.
answered in the way that I thought they were. So we do know this, that the answer from heaven doesn't always come in the way that we suspect. But I do say this, that your prayers always will be answered in one form or one fashion or another. So we do know this today. K.P. Yohannan, which is probably, I think we support him in this church more than any other missionary. And K.P. Yohannan in the Gospel for Asia. And if you ever read behind his ministry and all those different things, you'll find that no doubt that that brother was somebody that was birthed in prayer. We know that his mother had five different boys, I believe it was, and she prayed for one of them to be a preacher in India. I mean, India, you understand how pagan it is. But we understand him being the youngest of all those children. He said that God answered that prayer, that God moved in it in their lives, and all of a sudden, him being the last child, that God answered that prayer. Is it not amazing? And do you think of it at times? Isn't it amazing that God is still answering prayers of people that have died years before? Oh, Ravi Zacharias is another Indian individual who is real good at debating and all these different things. And he told a story one time about prayer. He said, you know, he was on a suicide bed. He said, because in India, he said, there's so many million different gods. He said he was so depressed, he didn't know which way to go. He had some family that were in Christianity. But he said he was so depressed because he didn't know where to go to find joy or peace. But there on his deathbed, he was on suicide watch. He had tried to take his own life. He said, there on his deathbed, he said he began to pray, and he said he got saved. And I forgot exactly what verse of Scripture he said he read when he gave his heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said years up the road, he never understood why God used that verse of Scripture that he read. And he said he don't know why God used that particular verse. He said, but years down the road, he was walking. He went to see his grave of his grandmother that he'd never seen before. And he said when he walked up to her grave, he said he looked there, and he said and on the inscription on the grave was the very verse that he read the day that he got born again. And he said to himself, he knew that the only reason he was saved was because he had a grandmother that at one point in one time had prayed for him and that had interceded on his family's behalf, and he was reaping from that answered prayer years up the road. I thought to myself, even in my own life, friends, I remember when my grandmother, and Brother Glenn knows her, Celia Chapel, my granddaddy LT was a pastor of a church. I remember when Celia Chapel, my grandmother, when she was older and age, and her mind wasn't there like it used to be. I mean, there were sometimes she would tell me to do things, and I'd tell me to pick up things that were not there, etc. But I remember one morning being about 12 years old, about 6 in the morning. I felt the end of my bed shaking. I'm telling you, I didn't know what it was. I didn't know if it was the boogeyman. I didn't check underneath the bed before I went to bed that night. But I will never forget, and it has been etched in my memory. I'll never forget what it was. As I looked at the end of my bed, and my grandma was at the foot of my bed. Parkinson, she was shaking the bed from shaking so much. And I heard her mind not all there. But she was saying these words like this, Lord, let Derek serve the Lord. I thought to myself, those times of even, I didn't get saved then. It was 8 years up the road before I gave my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. And she died when I was about 17 years old. But I'll tell you this today, why am I saying all this? I'm letting you know that prayer still works. Even though you may pray tonight or pray at home, and like I said tonight, I know this may be scattered, but wherever you're praying at, my friends, you would understand that even though you don't see the instant result right then, understand that God still honors the prayers of the saints. God still honors your prayers. We can read throughout the Bible so many different things. We know this, that prayer is God's method of carrying out His purposes here on this earth. I'm telling you, church, if we don't pray, if we are not men and women that are given to prayer, we cannot expect God to forward His kingdom in our families or even in this community. That is the only way that it's going to be done. And quite honestly, that's why I believe the enemy fights prayer so much, because he knows that if you really pray and you pray fervently, something is going to happen. And the devil understands that, and the devil knows that, my friend. We can read throughout history, and there's so many different people that I look at. There's a man by the name of Praying John Hyde. Anybody ever heard of John Hyde? He was a man that prayed so much, you would understand that John Hyde in the late 1800s, he left his home in Illinois to serve the Lord as a missionary to the people of India. There he labored, not just physically, but more important, he labored in prayer. He was known to stay up late in the night praying, as well as rising early each morning, crying out to God. And this is what he would say. People would walk by his room and would hear him say these words in prayer. Give me souls, O God, or I'm going to die. Give me souls, O God, or I'm going to die. He was so gripped with the passion for the lost that he knew that the strongholds of the enemy had been upon the people of India. He said this, I could preach to them to the day that I die, but if I do not pray for them, he said, there will be no hope for humanity in this region or in this area. Church, we've got to do more than preach. You've got to do more than know doctrine. You've got to do more than know the Bible, but you've got to pray, and you've got to ask God to open up doors of fervency and effectual that things can be accomplished in His kingdom. You'll find throughout the Bible and the New Testament that Paul often said this, that a door was opened unto him, and that he would pray, and that a door was opened in this region or that region. He wasn't talking about a physical door. He was talking about a spiritual door where the gospel could have free course into the minds of individuals. And my friend, that's why the Bible tells us this, how great of a mystery it is, and how about when it comes to seeing souls won. It says the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray that the Lord of the harvest will send out laborers into the vineyards and to the harvest. We've got to pray if we're going to see anything done for the kingdom of God. Praying John Hyde, my friend, prayed so much that the day that he died, when they looked at his chest, they said he prayed so much and had so much sorrow in prayer that his heart actually shifted out of his chest cavity, out of his cavity that it was supposed to be. That his heart shifted from one place to the other. That's praying. James in the Bible, they called him camel knees because he prayed so much. I forget the name of the brother, and I want to say his last name was Owens, and forgive me if I'm wrong, but he was a gentleman that God one time spoke to him. He was an old pioneer preacher. And God spoke to him to go to a certain auditorium in a certain city. He said, go there and preach. When this evangelist went this area, he said he walked into the auditorium. He seen a janitor there. He said, God told me to come here and preach. He said, you ain't preaching here, sir. He said, you have to add this. He said, they don't want no Christians. He said, actually, the mayor of the town said these words, that as long as this auditorium is here, there will be no preacher that's going to get on this podium or get on this auditorium platform and say anything. That's what he said. He said, and God kept on telling him, you need to pray about this. He said, he went into the woods. And this is a true story. He said he went into the woods and he said he got in an old hollowed out log. He said he crawled in there. He said when he crawled in this old hollowed out log, he said he began to pray, and he said instantly he felt the spirit of intercession come upon him. He knew the Holy Ghost was anointing him to pray for that city. And he said as he went in that log, he said he was there for 3 different days. He said he didn't leave there. He laid in that hollowed out log and he prayed. He said when he got hungry, he said a squirrel would come down from a tree and drop walnuts down to him. And he said, we'd eat them walnuts. He'd stand that long for 3 different days. He said, and eventually God spoke to him and said, there's an abandoned house in the town. He said, go in that town. He said, begin to pray. He said, he went in that town. And he said, when he went to this old abandoned house, he said, he walked up the steps of the old abandoned house. He said, he went upstairs. He said, there was no furniture in the room. He said, he laid on his face. And he said, once again, he felt the spirit of intercession come upon him. And he said, he began to pray. And he said, there on the floor, in the middle of that room was a big old hole in the board, like a knot hole in it. And he heard somebody come in the house. He said he put his eye down in that little hole in the floor. And he said as he looked downstairs, he seen a family come in. He said they had tears in their eyes. He said they got down and they began to pray. He said that family gave the heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, next thing you know, he said, he kept on praying. True story, you read it. I have to find his name. He kept on praying. Another family would come in. He said, eventually, it worked out when he went to the auditorium. He said, when he went there, he said, come to find out, there were so many people that had gotten saved in that town that once again, he had enough petitions, he could go to that auditorium and he could preach the gospel. What are you trying to say, Brother Dick? I'm trying to say this. We've got to pray if we're going to see anything get done. Now, as we think about this, I like, when it comes to prayer, I'm be honest with you. I'm not going to say I'm an expert. I'm far from it. You ever heard the idea of learning to pray? I've got down quite a few times I'm still learning. Amen. When I think I got to figure it out, I feel like the heavens are brass. And you know what I have to do? I have to go back to the throne and say, God, I ain't got a clue what I'm doing. It's amazing when it comes to prayer. There's so many different tactics used. I've been to certain prayer meetings and they kind of change their voice as if God is going to hear them if they speak in old English. Come on. I'm serious. I heard one guy one time and I thought to myself, I ain't understand nothing he just said. You can speak in Old English. I do. Lord, Thou art worthy, Thou art faithful. That's Old English. God understands plain English too. Amen. You know, you ever think about this? You know, God understands my prayer in English. God understands somebody else's prayer in Swahili. God understands somebody's prayer in Chinese, Japanese, Russian, I mean Spanish. God knows all the languages. Amen. And there's times, my friend, you may not find words to put it in, but God still knows. My friend, you've got to grow when it comes to prayer. My friend, if you still pray the way you used to, when you never break through, I'm telling you, you can learn to pray, and you can learn to be submissive to the Spirit, and you can learn that the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. There's no pattern given in the Bible. This is what the Bible says. You need to pray, and that's what you need to do. He didn't give a formula so much. Yes, we can pray the Lord's Prayer, but if that's all you say, my friend, you've got to learn to pray, and not only pray, but you've got to learn to pray through. You ever heard of praying through, that old term, praying through? I often say this, the day you got saved, that's exactly what you did. You may not put it, you didn't know the terminology then, did you? But you got down the altar and said, Lord, I'm rotten and I'm sorry and I'm a sinner. And God says, I know. Lord, come into my heart. He comes in. You pray through. I said, but it amazes me, Christians 5 years up the year, 5 years up the road, they don't have to pray through no more because they learn better. They go down and pray and they say, well, God, I still go to the altar and say, God, forgive me, Lord, if there's anything, search me, oh God. You read the Bible, there's many different prayers. I like, you read the book of Psalms, you never find David walking in like he's got it down pat. He goes in there and says, Lord, can you incline your ear like, please listen to me. My enemies are around me. They're everywhere, Lord. And I love about the book of Psalms, we've been studying them in Sunday school. You can tell when David's actually praying through too. He said, because all of a sudden you see a shift in the Psalms, and all of a sudden they'll say things like this, Thou the glory, You the lifter of my head. He says this, You make my feet like hinds' feet. You can tell that all of a sudden he goes into that prayer closet, spiritually speaking. He's coming out, my friend. He said, Lord, You made my feet like hinds' feet. I feel like I can jump over mountains. I feel like I can run through a troop. I feel like I can leap over a wall. Why is that? Because he prayed through. Why do we carry things so much? You know, I like that song, Sweet Hour of Prayer. Oh, it's sweet, isn't it? I say this probably every other Sunday, but every time I pray through, I say, God, why didn't I do this yesterday? And then, you know, I find myself 2 months later, I wish I'd done it yesterday again. Because I find out prayer is the answer. Prayer is the answer. We got to grow in prayer. Leonard Ravenhill says, he tells a story about a group of tourists who were visiting a village. And as they walked by a village, my friend, he said this. He said, there was an old man sitting by a fence. One of the tourists, in a rather patronizing way, said this. He turned to the old man and asked the question, were any great men born in this village? And the old gentleman said, no, just babies. What was he saying? If anybody's become great, it's because they grew in it. It wasn't because they were born great. My friend, same thing spiritually. You don't all of a sudden wake up. You're not born again great. Yes, it's great grace, amazing grace. You're saved, it's freedom. But you still got to grow in your walk with the Lord. And you still got to grow in faith through prayer. Many times, my friend, I hear people say these words, Brother Derek, I'm too busy to pray. I'm too busy. Does anybody else have a busy life? I know. For some reason, and Brother Glenn probably knows this, but people think a pastor don't have nothing to do. My brother, my brother, he's younger, he's not born again. He said, I wish I had your job, Brother. He said, I wish I had your job, Derek. You work once a week. I said, you don't even have a clue. You don't even have a clue. I tell him, I said, God can't even trust you with 30 minutes of free time. I said, you'd waste it. I said, God's got to trust you, amen. But you understand today that people say, I feel like that sometimes, to be honest with you, as a pastor, you were visiting and seeing different people and studying. I don't know why. Some people, I wonder, I asked one preacher, I said, how long do you study to preach? He said, about 2 hours. I said, is that it? I feel like I'm in the Garden of Gethsemane for 2 days. I still get nervous up here. You may not see it, but I'm a nervous wreck sometimes. But we understand this, busy. You could say, all of us could say our lives are busy. There's something going on, job and schedules and deadlines and groceries. And I've got a newborn baby at home. I know. Busy, busy, busy. But I still got to pray. Amen. This is something I read one time about John Wesley's mother. And I'm trying to think of her name right now. But anyway, John Wesley's mother, I believe it was, yeah, it was John Wesley. My mind, her name was Susanna Wesley. Actually, this woman of God was a mother of 19 children and was known for her devoted prayer life. She was up there with the Duggars. 19 children. But all of her kids said this, I've never seen a woman pray so much. You would say, how in the world would 19 kids? I mean, I'm not talking back then, you know. You couldn't just sit them down in some way and let something else entertain them. You had 19 kids before electricity. You had 19 kids before all these other blessed things that we have nowadays. But they said all the time, in the midst of her busy household and numerous duties, she said she consistently made time to pray. They said she would sit there in the kitchen while something was cooking, and she would take her apron and pull it over her head, and you'd hear her praying. She'd find time to pray. It said, even as busy as she were, and my friend, this is the truth, it was out of her prayers that two of her sons, John and Charles Wesley, became two key leaders in the 1700s, and all of us can feel the effects of his ministry, and all we also still sing the hymns that Charles Wesley wrote of that day. But my friend, it came from a praying mother. But this is something I want you to understand. When we pray to the Lord, we pray like He's a distant cousin or something. How many knows that? You ever been to a family reunion? I don't know if y'all have. We have them in Virginia. Come on. A lot of you. I've got some family reunions. I'm related to people I didn't have a clue. You ever been to a family reunion and you still sit with the people you know? And you wonder about the food. I'm like, Grandma, what'd you make? She said, I made that. I said, all right, I'm going straight for that. Amen. But family reunions, you know, sometimes, I hope this ain't the case, but in my own life, I spend my times praying. And I said, Lord, I really don't want to pray. I want to pray more fervent than this. I don't want to get in such a routine or be so dull in my prayer life. We all understand this, but I need to be reminded that we need to have childlike faith when we pray. I don't know if you've ever noticed a child talking to her mom and dad when they want something. And I'm not talking about the brats that just throw temper tantrums, but I'm talking about when they're trying to make a peace treaty, you know? You don't have to get out a dictionary and understand what they're saying. Mama, hungry, thirsty, tired. I'm crying, I'm hurt. My friends, when you go to God, He's your Heavenly Father. You're His child. Don't complicate it. If you're hurting, go to Him and say, Father, I'm hurt. If you feel like it's too heavy, go to God and say, Lord, I can't pick it up no more. You know, my dad has 2 acres of land back in North Carolina, and you've never seen so many pine trees. I mean, there's pine trees, and I hate them. You hate, because my dad, if he did it for a hobby, but he liked cutting them down. And he'd wake us up about Saturday morning. Let's go cut some pine tree branches, and do this, and every now and then I get hold of one, as a 10, 11-year-old boy, one I couldn't carry on my own. And I'm sitting there dragging and dragging. But I'm telling you, friend, I didn't mind when it was too heavy. I tell Daddy, I can't do it. He'd come over there and get hold of it. I could tell he was helping me. Why is it as Christians, do we not look to Him as our Heavenly Father? When you can't carry it, quit struggling so much and give it to God. Let God be the one that helps you. My friend, one of the most beautiful experiences for me is when I hear little children pray. And there's a man that did a study one time. He actually listened to kids pray. And he wrote them down. This is what one child said. His name was Hank by the age of 7. He said this, Dear Lord, thank You for a nice day today. You even fooled the TV weatherman. He was talking about how comical it is to hear children pray. But how sometimes it'll make you laugh. And sometimes it'll make you cry. Another young boy by the name of David, 8-year-old, said this, Do you ever get mad, God? My mother gets mad all the time, but she is only human. Do you get mad? You ever heard children, even David, at the age of 7 years old, another boy by the name of David, he said, Lord, I need a raise in my allowance. Could You have one of Your angels tell my daddy? But you know, friends, I've been around children, and with tears running down their face, and say things like this, I don't know why Mama died. And they don't know. I don't know. I think it was recently I heard of somebody and talked to somebody, and anyhow, they were talking about how a little child was up the stairs crying for the mama and daddy, or mother, I think it was for the daddy, one that had passed on. And I think to myself, Lord, they go to You with such bold faith. Why can we not do the same things as adults? Why can we not do the same thing? Matthew 18:3 says this, Jesus turned to His disciples that were gathered around Him, unless you become as little children, you will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. He was letting us know, my friend, just the way a child in His simplicity and His trust and is a perfect portrait of what the new believer is. My friend, you've got to become as a child. He is still your Heavenly Father, and you still can talk to Him as your Heavenly Father. We would understand that Jesus, in the book of John chapter 17, we understand this, it says that Jesus, when He prayed, we find the same picture. Jesus says this, as He lifted His eyes to heaven, He said, Father. That's what Jesus did. You know, sometimes we get caught up on the posture of prayer. There's many different postures in prayer. The Bible speaks of prostrating oneself, kneeling, lifting holy hands, praying aloud on the street corners. But Jesus did this in John 17. He lifted His hands, looked up towards heaven and said, Father, I need You. Father, He didn't say, I need You, but He said, Father, He was letting me know this is what I desire, the high priestly prayer. We understand that, God, we can do the same thing. We have to come to Him as we have to come to Him because He is our Heavenly Father. But this is something else I want us to understand. If He's our Heavenly Father, you need to come to Him as you are. Sometimes the mentality that enters into some people's prayer life is this, I've got to wait till I'm good enough to go to Him. No, you don't. You can go to Him right now. You know, when it comes to being born again, you know, I understand the sinner's prayer. He hears a prayer of repentance. I know that. We could study all that, but when you get saved and you're still immaturity, different maturity ages and different things like this, I understand this. You cannot always wait till you're perfect to go to Him. If you wait till you're perfect, you'll never pray. I think of the prodigal son. You know, it's amazing. He goes out into the far country. He squanders his living. And then he says this. He said, I will go where? I'm going to go home. Because he knew where he could go. But we understand that this is what he said in his mind. He said, because he has bread enough and to spare, and I'm willing just to be a servant. But the Bible tells us this, that when he goes home, that we see the heart of the Father, that the Father is running to him, and the Father doesn't give him bread, but the Bible says he embraced him, he rejoiced, and he celebrated. I believe, my friend, that parable, more than is a picture of the prodigal son, it shows us something about our Heavenly Father as well. Now, what if that prodigal son sat in the hog pen and said, I'm going to wait till I save up $10,000, get a good meal, and then I'm going to go home? No. Church, if you're waiting to get perfect, run to Him now. Pray, pray, pray. Why should we pray before? I'll tell you why. Because the Bible tells us to. Simple things to go over. And why, my friend, we can also ask prayer. Why do we pray? We pray because God had promised to answer us. Bible, that's what the Bible says. It says, you have not because you ask not. Let me put it in simple terms. You say this is elementary. I know. I want you to get this. If you want a loved one saved, ask Him. Amen. My friend, if you want America to have revival, ask Him. If you want a Abundant Life Tabernacle to grow, ask Him. If you want something to happen in your family, in a church, or somewhere in there, whatever it is, you've got to ask Him, and our God is faithful to answer. God delights in answering our prayers. And that's what the Bible tells us. He is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. The Bible tells us, ask and it will be given. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it will be opened. The Bible tells us, if you abide in Me and My words abide in you, you will ask and you will be answered. He tells us that God still answers prayer, but you've got to pray for Him to answer them. Now, what I think of this is very unique, that Cornelius in the Bible was a Gentile. He prayed and God sent Peter. I could read throughout the Bible, Elijah prayed and it didn't rain for 3.5 years. Daniel prayed and God honored that. From the belly of a fish, Jonah prayed and God heard him. Even from the belly of a fish when he's running from God. I have a message I preach on that. Maybe God will let us preach it. I preach on, oh, what a fish, but oh, what an altar. Talk about how big the fish is, but how great was that altar inside the fish. Sometimes you don't realize how important the altar is to you in the most trying time of your life. You'll find you pray like you've never prayed before. You pray like you never prayed before. We also understand that Hagar prayed. Hagar was an Egyptian. We know that how Abraham got ahead of God's will. Hagar prayed and God heard her. Moses prayed and God answered them. My friend, also we could go around this room. Has God ever answered a prayer for anybody in this room? By the raise of hands, if you don't mind. I'm not breaking. 100%. I believe prayer works. The Bible says so and you say so and I believe you. And I say so, and I hope you believe me. Amen. Prayer still works. Now, my friend, we're going to ask this question. How should we pray? We should pray with absolute confidence. We should pray with a thankful heart. We should pray remembering our relationship with others. The Bible says you get an altar against your brother, you come to the altar, you know, you leave it there, you go make it right. Come back. You know, we make it right. We ought to pray, and guess what? You can be specific in your prayers. You ever think about it? Be specific. And not just the color car you want. But I'm talking about specific spiritually. Specific prayers. My friend, but also one of the most important things, you need to pray with a burden. You need to pray with a burden. You say, Brother Derek, how do you get a burden? Pray for one. You'll find one. You'll find one. If you ain't got a burden, read the newspaper. You'll find one real quick. If you're born again, you'll find burdens. Pray for a burden, my friend. Breakthrough in prayer comes to a heart that is burdened by the Holy Spirit. And my friend, you can read in the book of Nehemiah how Nehemiah, when he heard about Jerusalem, my friend, he was so burdened that he could not even regulate his own expression and emotion because of the grief he had over the suffering of God's people. And the king could look at him and said, "Something is wrong. What's wrong with you, Nehemiah?" I believe you can have such a burden that people can look at you and say, "What's on your mind today?" And you can say, "Oh, it's the sinfulness of humanity. It's what's taking place in this world." We can read about the life of Hannah in the Bible praying for a child. We can read about David and Paul. You'll find the passion and the burden that they had. But also, my friend, this. You need to pray in faith, believing that He's going to do something. Why is it that we would pray if we don't even believe that God can do it? If you're doing it just because it's a routine, it's wrong. It's wrong. You need to pray. I need to pray. My last point, and we're just going to go over something real quick, and I won't be much longer. But I've heard people say this before, prayer is boring. And I'm going to be honest with you. I have prayed before and it got boring. You may tell you why, because I wasn't praying in the Spirit. Learn to pray and pray in the Spirit. If you're just going there with a routine of words that you've practiced all week. I read about Hindu priests. They'll put a fan in front of their mouth and think it chops their prayers up, makes them more. If you're praying out of routine, my friend, it will get boring. I'm sorry. I mean, I'm telling you the truth. Religion will get boring if you're just doing a routine of words that you practice. You know, saying, "Look, I'm going to pray this today, and I'm going to pray this today, and God, I hope you answer it, Lord. Oh, man, I'm tired, busy, I'm going to bed." But what about when you really get down and you say, "Lord, help me pray." Ask God to help you pray. My wife sings a song, and I love it. It's called, "Pray Through Me, Holy Spirit. Pray Through Me When I'm Weak." It's talking about praying through you, asking the Holy Ghost, "Lord, help me pray." Yes, there's sometimes you're praying by faith. I know that. Yes, I know, my friend. Yes, sometimes there's so much pressure upon us and so busy. But my friend, when all of this is taking place, sometimes you have to admit and tell God, "Lord, I need your help. I really don't understand how to pray about this, what I'm facing." It's all right to go to God and tell Him, "Help me. I need a burden. I need you to help me pray." And let's not complicate this, my friend. Don't try to figure it out. But the book of Romans chapter 8 tells us that the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, makes intercession with things that cannot even, symbols, things that cannot be uttered. There's sometimes you get down to pray. You ever got down to pray and you start crying and you hadn't even said anything yet? Because the Spirit of God is interceding on your behalf and says, "You don't even know how to put it into words, but this is exactly what you need." I've gotten down to pray before, and what I thought I needed, God gave me something else. And just out of a broken heart, I'm crying. I'm praying. Say, God, I was praying for the wrong thing the whole time. And God worked anyhow because He knew I was being sincere. Man, God's grace. They're a lot more present than what we think at times. There's times you're praying for the wrong thing, and God will give you the right thing. There's times God knows exactly what you have need of. My friend, prayer is so important. We have to understand we need to pray, we need to pray, we need to pray. In light of all what is happening in our country right now, we need to pray. We read the book of Acts chapter 4, and we hear this story about them praying and what happened to the building they were in. It said it shook. I just jotted down. I know this is scattered and wouldn't go with a perfect outline. I'm not too homiletical tonight, but hear me. We understand when they prayed in Acts chapter 4, it was a united prayer meeting, and they all lifted their voice in one accord to God. We understand what happened. Their praying was based solidly on the Word of God. Matter of fact, you can read Psalms chapter 2. They were even quoting verses of Scripture. And another thing you'll notice about this, they were praying, and they were praying to be empowered. They were praying to a sovereign God. They approached Him as the Creator. And this is what I liked about it more than anything. They were not praying for protection. They were praying for power. In light of all this going on in our country and what's going on in this world, church, let's pray. But let's pray with a burden. Let's pray in the Spirit and know that God hears us every time we do. Another story from K.P. Yohanan, and we'll pray here in just a moment. But K.P. Yohanan was once again, he said that when they were looking for a missionary, he said they were looking for a pastor of a certain church. He said there was a man that recently had gotten saved. He had no college education. He had no learning. They say he was a complete man that was completely illiterate. And they said when they were looking for this individual, he saw a pastor in a church. And next thing you know, he planted 5 more churches. They said they went to him finally. He said, let's find out what he's doing because it's working so well in that region. How's he outreaching? They said when they went there and they found him, they asked him a question. Sir, what are you doing? He said, I get up every morning at 5. He said, I pray for 3 hours. He said, I read the Bible for 2 hours. He said, then God does all the work. If you try to do everything within your own strength, you're going to be miserable. You'll get tired. I've learned this as a preacher, and please take my word for it. Any time that I've been trying to operate in the flesh in any form, even though when it seems innocent, I'll find myself confused, frustrated, and exhausted. You try to build something on your own merit. You try to do something on your own. I've learned this. I remember when I was on the evangelistic field, I got so wore out one time. You can ask my wife. I was so burnt out. And I remember getting down and praying, and I felt God just tenderly touch my heart. Say, quit trying to do it yourself. Let me do it. And I found that through ministry, when I take my hands off it, even like tonight, I don't know, God wants to talk about prayer. What do I do? I had an outline for the gifts of the Spirit. What do? I'm going to talk about prayer. That's what God wants. K.P. Yohanan, once again, he said he was having a meeting. And he said, let's pray. He said, before they enter into the meeting, he said, let's pray. He said, as they were praying, he said, the Spirit of Christ became so present in that room. He said that as they were praying, he was sitting there, as he was praying, he looked around, people were weeping. And he said all of a sudden he had this idea that you ever had while you were praying, God give you something to do that you don't want to do it because everybody else is going to look at you and think you're crazy? I remember one time years ago, we'll get back to the story, that there was a sister that preached, and a good evangelist, and preached about having the keys. And I remember I had a set of keys in my pocket. I remember I was sitting there praying, and God said, take those keys and just shake them. I said, oh Lord, I ain't shaking them keys. They think I'm a plumb crazy. And I'd got weeping. Shake them keys. I said, oh. I remember I'd take them keys out. And I remember taking them, and I simply, where's I got some keys? Yeah, right here. I just went like this. I said, I've got the victory tonight. And I'll tell you, I never seen God operate so supernaturally. People were getting filled and touched. Nothing to do with me, but just obey the Lord in prayer. Obey Him. K.P. Yohanan said he felt in his heart, get a chair out and set it in the middle of this group. He said, I got a chair out and set in the middle of that group. And he said, God told me to speak to him. Saying, God's in this room. Jesus Christ, right now while you're praying, He's present with you. And he said, when you're in India, he said, anytime somebody's greater is in the room, he said, everybody stands up. He said, they stood up and they just began to pray. And God answered the prayer that they had need of. Stand to your feet tonight. Mainly tonight, I know this may seem simple, but I felt in my heart and convicted in my own spirit, we've got to do more than just complain about what's happening in our country. We've got to pray. We've got to pray. You have not tonight, church, because you ask not. I stand here in confidence tonight to say this. If you pray, God knows your heart. God knows your needs. But let me encourage you. Do not abandon the simplicity of prayer in your life. Stop it. Whatever you're doing that you think works and is not working, quit it and pray. I feel God just to tell you that. Quit trying to do it and pray. Give it to God. Pray about it. And I want everyone in this room to examine yourself. Please be honest with yourself, as I'm honest with myself right now. Do you pray like you need to? Do you pray like you need to? I will be the pastor of the church and raise my hand. I need to pray more. I will. Do you pray? I try, brothers and sisters. Do I pray? I believe you pray, and I hope you believe I pray. But I want to pray more. As we're about to cut, in 1 second, David Wilkerson, years ago, I listened to a sermon he preached on the cost of a fresh anointing. He said that when God used him and sent him to New York City to deal with drug addicts, he said he would go in the woods and he would pray for hours. And he'd tell his wife, when somebody comes to this house and they want me, point to the woods. If it's an emergency, come drag me out. Come tell me in the woods. I'll walk out. He said, but leave me alone. I'm praying. He'd lay there by an old stump and pray. He said, after he had published and went to New York City, he published Crossing the Switchblade and he even made a movie out of it and some stuff he completely disagreed with in it. He said, after he even made a movie out of it, he said, he's going to be honest with you. He said, all that fame went right here. He said, I'm going to be honest with you. He said, I was missing the mind of God when I was preaching. He said, I was booked for years. He said, I had so many meetings I needed to preach. He said, and he finally, one night, he realized this. He said, he realized he missed it. He said, he preached on marriage in a room full of drug addicts. He said, he didn't know who was going to be there. He said, but a man spontaneously showed up with drug addicts. He said, the man met him after service and said, David, what's going on? You just don't seem like yourself. The anointing's not there like it used to be. He said, he began to cry. He said, when he got back on the bus, he told his manager, he said, cancel every meeting I've got planned. I don't care. He said, I'm not offending nobody. He said, but I've got to find God again. He said, he went home and he said, he sat there and was praying and just weeping and said, Lord, I'm so dry. Anybody know what I'm talking about, a dry spell? You know what I'm talking about? He said, Lord, I'm dry. He said, him and Leonard Ravenhill. Anybody heard of Leonard Ravenhill? He said, come knocking on his door. He said, David, what you doing? He said, I'm upset. He said, here's a book, read it. It was a book like William Grudem, The Whole Armor of God. It's 1,000 pages. Give it a shot. He said, he got to page 19 and he felt it burning again. God spoke these words to him. He said, David, if you're going to do what you did at one time, it's going to cost you exactly the same thing. Seek my face. He said he'd go in the prayer closet and he said he felt it ignite once again, Brother Glenn. He said he'd look at his clock, got an appointment. He said, God said, put that watch in your pocket and pray. Put that watch in your pocket and pray. That's when he established Times Square Church, not far after. Tells us this tonight, church, pray. Does everybody understand what I said tonight? And with that simple thought tonight, all of us on an equal playing field, can we find a place and pray and ask God to move? Amen. You're welcome to pray anywhere you desire.